Hello, welcome back to this class. As said, we would be talking about urban transportation policy, which is an recent happening, and we have the National Transit Oriented Development Policy that has been recently framed, which is very, very important both for your objective papers as well as your subjective papers. Now, coming on to firstly the idea of urban mobility. So when we talk about urban mobility, it's not that we count by the number of cars that exist in a country. We count by the number of rich who can move or use public transportation. So our sole idea is to enhance the issue of public transportation. Once the public transportation is good, it would have multiple benefits, like it would reduce the carbon footprint, the atmospheric pollution would be reduced, the problem of traffic congestion would be reduced. So all these are associated phenomena. So this concept is not only prevalent in India, but throughout the world where you have major metropolitans, the metropolitans are facing the issues of urban transportation due to problem of parking spaces, problem of traffic, and so on and so forth. So what we need to move forward is a society where we have less car dependent lifestyle. We have much more cleaner fuel, cleaner vehicle that we go for. The mobility is well managed. So even if there is traffic, the management of traffic is good. The safety and security is good. You have logistics and freights that are taken into account. If we talk about the global scenario, you have 25% of the greenhouse gas emission that comes from only and only urban transport, and 30% of the urban transport trips that are done are mainly for the work purpose. So work becomes a predominant aspect under urban transportation. If we need to work around solutions for urban transportation and we devise ways in which you have a kind of less car dependent lifestyle, you have a last mile connectivity, that's another aspect under the National Transport Oriented Development Program. So all those policies look forward for managing the issues of urban sprawl. Urban sprawl means a kind of haphazard development that happens. So let's say this is a city expansion that is at present. What would happen under an urban sprawl? Urban sprawl can take place in any direction and in any amount. So let's say the growth of the city in this direction is much more as compared to here and there. So what would happen? There would be a leapfrog development, or what we call as haphazard development, and since there is development without planning, it would lead to problems of traffic, it would lead to problems of congestion, it would lead to problems of parking spaces. In order to address all these issues, what can be the possible solutions? The possible solutions can be devising a metro line, moving through BRTS, the bus rapid transport system, devising ways to solve traffic congestion, that could be promoting carpooling. So some of the nations work around promoting carpooling as one of the efforts, because in certain areas, creating metro or working around BRTS is not a feasible solution. Now, share of public transport in India, if we talk about, was around 30% in 2011, which is expected to drop to only 22% by 2021. So what the thing is basically is more and more people are going towards an idea of having their own vehicles, and therefore the problem of traffic further increases, the use of public transportation further decreases. So as we said, these are some of the common solutions. The fourth important common solution would be using non-motorized transportation vehicles that can be in the form of bicycles, walking, pedestrian traffic. So if we want to enhance the pedestrian or walking traffic, we need to bring things more into the reach or approachability. Now, considering all these, we have some of the ideas that have come forward. First is intermodal integration. Now, this integration talks about integration of the physical characteristics, integration of information technology, and integration of fare charges. Then we talk about land value capture policy. That's indeed another very important aspect. Now, what happens basically is, the center is not now financing the local authorities and asking the local authorities to become financially autonomous. What does that mean? That means these local bodies have to have their own funds in order to work around the issues of the city. So for that, what happens is a common thing that is popular is the land value capture policy. Let's say you have a major road that passes through the city. Now across this major road, what government did was government established the basic necessities that were required. And then once the road was completed and built up, the nearby areas were sold to the private contractors. And with this land capture, you have the impact fees that is charged, and that is very, very important. So what happens under this impact fees is all new developments would be charged. All the existing developments that are present there would have to pay only the improvement fees. They won't have to pay the overall fees, and the new development would be charged annually for a period of 16 years or 20 years. So what would happen during that time? During that time, the land value would appreciate. So it's basically a three-stage procedure where first you have the value that's created, the value that's captured for the improvement purposes, and once the local bodies or the ULBs have this impact fees that they get in, this money is further utilized for development of roads, sanitation, parks, open spaces, so on and so forth. So all the municipal development that you can see is a result of the fees that is collected through impact fees. So impact fees is one of that. There are numerous other taxes and fees that the urban authorities levy on the individuals. So impact fees we have already talked about. Beside impact fees, you have a list of other fees. For let's say, for example, change of land use. So if you are converting your land from agriculture to commercial, you would have to pay certain amount of fees. Now all these fees are either one time or recurring. So let's say change of land use is a one time fees. Then transfer of development rights, when you talk about it, it's a transaction based fees. Vacant land, if you have, on that vacant land you will have to give a tax, and that would be a kind of recurring tax. So each of these taxes vary. Some of these are one time and some of those are recurring. Some of these are area based, some of those are project based. So all this differ, and these are the ways through which the urban bodies collect money which can be used for the development further. Now the next model that we talk about is very, very interesting. It's known as the National Transit Oriented Development Policy. And under this policy, let's understand what the government plans to do. So you have, let's say, a metro line that would be running. You would have numerous metro stations that would be developed. Now this metro line which is running would have, let's say, an area around this metro line which would be highly approachable. So people can just walk and get their daily things, the daily requirements can be fulfilled. The fruits, vegetables, the normal vendors can be found there. Either, if not possible by walking, it can be through a bicycle ride. So what would happen is, this area which is in a proximity of around 10 to 15 minutes of the transportation system would be known as the influence zone. So under this influence zone, you would have a high foot traffic, you would have numerous pedestrians that would be seen, and most of the commodities or most of the things can be availed within that influence zone. Now again, besides this influence zone, you would have a mixed land use region. Under this mixed land use regions, you would have open spaces, hospitals, schools, colleges, so on and so forth. So that would be beyond the zone of influence, and this would be known as a mixed land use region. Why it would be known as a mixed land use? Because you would have low rise buildings, you would have high rise buildings, you would have open spaces, you would have schools, hospitals, colleges, so on and so forth. Now again, government plans to put an idea that under this mixed land use region, you would have some buildings with high floor area ratio and other buildings which are low rise. So some of the buildings would be high rise, which can accommodate huge density of population. Other buildings in those areas would be low rise. Again, government plans to bring around the issue of economically weaker section. So some of the region, the built up region, of that built up region, around 10 to 15% would be reserved for the economically weaker section in the high rise buildings or so. Again, there would be area of around 30%, that would be 60 square meters or less of area, which would provide housing to numerous people, and therefore high population density could be sustained in that region. Again, it would promote the use of public transport. As a result, it would reduce the carbon footprint. It would integrate the weaker section with the well-developed section. So it would be a kind of inclusive growth that could be seen in that area. And again, since this area is a kind of closed networking, you would have more safety issues that can be taken into account. Furthermore, there would be the area, so we talked about the influence zone. The next is the high density compact area development, which would have high rise buildings, higher population density. We talked about the mixed use, which would have schools, hospitals, parks. Then we also talked about the inclusive housing that's under this policy, where you would have provisions for the economically weaker section. This would have a multimodal integration, which we said it would include the physical fairs, the informational integration and the fair integration. The most important thing here is park and ride facility. So most of this region would have a park and ride facility. That means you can park your vehicle here. You can either use a common sharing vehicles or you can use cycles for commuting to a specific area. So there would be feeder buses. So the first priority would be given to the pedestrians. Next to it would be the bicycles. You would have feeder buses. Then you would have drop-off facilities, and finally the park and ride facility, which would be given the least preference. So government wants to create a plan for inclusive growth, where you have more and more people who are using the common facilities and having a last mile connectivity, which is the basic idea of this policy. So as we said, these are the components that are under the transit-oriented development program. So all these should be captured. Along with that, you have some other issues that we need to address. We are trying to preserve the open spaces. So under the mixed land use, beyond the high density section, you would have the open spaces, open parks, open areas, greenery, managed parking would be there, traffic calmness. As more and more people would be using the public transport, the traffic on the roads would be relieved. So this will reduce the volume and the problem of congestion. Then you have the land value capturing financing that would increase in this region. So as a result, you would have higher land values that would result into higher fees for the urban authorities. Street vendors are very, very important. Government has said that they won't remove the street vendors from that region, and rather they would be given designated spaces within the city. What would be the benefit of this? The major benefit would be the street vendors are basically the eyes of the city. So they know any kind of activity that's going around in the region, and this would bring in more security. So any kind of opaque walls would be avoided. There would be vending zones and active frontage that would be given. So all those would look into the security issues. Again, there were numerous awards and honors that have been given regarding the best city services, the best city bus. Some of the important ones are Hyderabad, known for its integrated traffic management system. Then you have Chittoor, which won the award for road safety because they have released a policy of no helmet, no petroleum. So if you do not have a helmet, you won't be having petrols in your two-wheelers. So that's another policy that has been released. So various cities are working in different ways to promote and manage the issues of urban transportation. Now, some of the focus areas for W49, we have already covered these in the class, the extra class that we took on the Oki cyclone this time, and the forthcoming lectures are here. So stay tuned, do subscribe to our channel. If you have any questions, definitely leave those as comment below the video. We'll be more than happy to resolve your doubts. Have a very good day ahead.